What I'm going to talk about is zombies in the Viking Age, basically the walking dead, the people who have died and come back to life and are animate. It's actually a lot more than that that I want to discuss. But all of this started when we shot our film on Greta's saga. Now, in Greta's saga, Greta encounters zombies and ghosts and many kinds of supernatural beings. And magic and sorcery play a big role in the story. So we wanted to find someone who could tell us more about this kind of supernatural creature and about this kind of sorcery and this kind of magic. Tell us more about ghosts and zombies. And we found this fellow, Jon Jonsson, a folklorist. And many people told us that he was the expert, that he knew this stuff inside and out, up and down. And we asked some of our friends, and they all said, yes, this is the man you want. So we talked to Jon for quite a long time, and it was amazing how much we learned about ghosts, about zombies, about mound dwellers, about sorcery, about witchcraft, about magic. And we wanted, you know, he had so much interesting to say that I wanted to research it more and present the results here in this presentation. So that's what this presentation will be. In addition, it's a little bit of an add-on to the presentation that I did a few months ago. So those watching online may want to see this presentation before you look at what goes on here. The other thing I want to do is connect some of these ancient practices with the modern practices, because it turns out there's a lot of commonalities between what went on in the old days and what went on in relatively recent times and even today. So I'd like to make those connections as well. You know, many heathen practices and beliefs continue in northern societies today. There's sort of a robustness to these heathen beliefs that allows them to continue century after century after century, even though the other religions, notably Christianity, have moved in and taken over in many ways. But there's this robustness about some of those beliefs. So that's one of the other things I want to talk about. One of the aspects of this robustness is this belief in zombies and ghosts. You know, this line between the living and the dead is blurred in these beliefs. And that line between life and death is really a key aspect to any religion. And so that is why I want to talk about these walking dead, you know, the people who are both alive and dead at the same time. So the title, since I'm using examples not only from the Viking Age, but all the way up into relatively modern times, this is probably a better title, Zombies Throughout the Ages in the northern lands. So very briefly, I'd like to talk about the sources we use to study this. Most of them are the same that we talk about, you know, month after month after month in this presentation. So I won't spend a lot of time on it. Just review, and especially one of the sources is something new for this presentation. We use the Eddas, you know, basically the basis for the old northern religion, these ancient Viking Age poems, even pre-Viking Age poems. And we also use the Snorra Edda, a collection of these ancient beliefs that were compiled into what was basically a textbook for young poets written by Snorri Sturluson very early in the 13th century. We use the Sagas, these stories set in Viking Age about historical people and historical events. And the new source that we haven't really talked about much before is what I would call folklore. So stories and tales and legends from the Renaissance into the early modern period. Now in Iceland, many of these tales were compiled by a fellow, Jon Arnason, and published as Þjóðsögur, which means folk tales. And so these folk tales talk a lot about these supernatural creatures and tell us about the beliefs in this later period. And so they become an important source to us. Now, what's common about all these sources, from the early Eddas all the way up into, you know, early modern times, is people believe that magic was real, that magic worked, that these entities, these supernatural creatures, were real, and that they had real power. So what I'd like to do is go through each of these sources that we talked about and talk about what they tell us about ghosts and zombies and these walking dead. So we'll start with the Eddas. And the Eddas tell us about the inhabit, basically the people who have died in battle and have been chosen by Odin to join him in Valhalla to prepare for the final battle at Ragnarok. Here in Valhalla, they spend all day fighting and then all night feasting and drinking. If they die in the fight, they're reanimated. They're brought back to life. So these are dead people who've been brought back to life and then die and are reanimated, die and reborn again and again and again. Definitely people who are dead and alive at the same time, preparing for the battle, Odin's chosen people. Another example is the dead in Hel. Hel is the underworld in the Norse mythology, and it's presided over by the goddess, also named Hel. So there are dead people in Hel, people who are living on Earth and now are living in Hel. And the myths tell us that at Ragnarok, they will sail aboard the ship Nalfar, which is a ship made of the toenails and fingernails of dead men. And so that is one of the beliefs of these ancient peoples, is that when someone dies, you should always trim their fingernails and toenails before they're buried so that the ship doesn't get too big, so that it can't carry too many people. So these are dead people, people who have died, they've gone to hell, and now they fight on the side of the giants against the gods at Ragnarok. Now, the meaning of the verse that describes this is really pretty obscure. It's hard to interpret. In addition, there's multiple versions of the story. So it's not exactly clear what's going on here. But what is clear is they fight on the side of evil, basically, on the side of the giants at Ragnarok. Another kind of dead, which is... are the servants of Hel, the goddess of the underworld. Her servants are called, are named Ganglati and Ganglut, which means lazy walking man and lazy walking woman. So these are the people who maybe have seen some of the modern movies about these slow shuffling zombies, because their names suggest that that is how they move, these servants of Hel in the underworld. Another example is Baldur, the brightest and wisest of the gods, killed by Hurdur, who was guided by Loki. After his death, his wife died from grief, and the two of them were put aboard their ship, and the ship was burned. And they traveled to Hel. Baldur and his wife were in Hel. And Hermoder was sent to try to bring them back, try to find a way to bring them back. So they were dead, but yet alive in Hel. The attempt was unsuccessful, and so they stay in Hel until Ragnarok. Baldur is one of the few of the gods who actually survives this final battle at Ragnarok. Another example from the Eddas is the Vulva, the seeress. The Eddas tell us that Odin, before Baldur's death, was curious to learn more about Baldur's death. And so he traveled to Hel, and he raised this vulva from the dead. So in essence, a zombie, if you will. He wanted the information that she had about what the future held, so that he could plan it and try to avoid Ragnarok. So again, raising someone from the dead to get the information that they possess. Another example is Mimir, a wise man, and after the first battle of the world between the Æsir and the Vanir, he was a hostage sent to the Vanir to secure the peace. And he was thought to be a wise man. He was an advisor, but he could only advise if he was with another advisor, whose name I forget, Hunir. He was helpless without that advisor. So the Vanir realized that he couldn't do anything for them. And so they killed him. They decapitated him and sent his head to Odin. And Odin keeps his head alive to use the advice that Mimir can provide. And he smears, he puts herbs on the head to preserve it. Again, another example of keeping someone alive through magic. A zombie, if you wish. Another example. In hell are many dead people. Many dead people go to hell. But it seems that there's something even more than that. So the Eddas tell us that you live, you die here in Mithgadu, you die, you go to hell, but you can die even more. The people who die in hell go to a special place, Niflhel. So it says that you can die, but you can die even more. Apparently there are several degrees of death. Another example, dwarves. Dwarves appear many times in the Eddas and also in the folklore. And what they have, what typically brings them together, what holds them, what is in common amongst them, is that they are clever smiths. They live underground. They're small and ugly. But there's some possibility that maybe they are the spirits of dead humans, demons of the dead, if you will. And one of the things that suggests that is some of their names. Some of the names for dwarves are listed here. You know, so they are death, they are corpse, they are black, the color of a corpse. So their names themselves suggest death. Another example from the Edda is Gultveig. She was the woman who basically caused the first war in the world. She came to Odin, and she talked about nothing but gold and her greed. And the Æsir very quickly grew tired of her nonsense talk. And so they pierced her through with spears and then burned her body. And she walked out of the fire. So they pierced her again and burned her again, and she walked out. They pierced her again and burned her again, and she walked out. Three times they killed her, and she came back to life. And this resulted in the first war in the world. The Vanir wanted to avenge this terrible treatment of Gultveig. So again, someone who was killed, but not dead. Odin himself has powers over the dead. Havamal tells us that he can cause the tongues of hanged men to speak. And Ynglinga Saga says that he can raise the dead and talk with them under the gallows. So he has the ability to raise the dead and bring them back to life. Another example, Raun, the goddess of the undersea realm. She is the one who accepts the men who have died from drowning. And the sagas tell us that if drowned men appeared at their own funeral, it meant that they had been well received by Hraun. And there's an example of that in Yrbigi Saga. A man named Thorradr drowned, and his boat and their cargo of fish washed up on the shore. And so his family had a funeral feast for him at the farm of Froda. And this is what the farm looks like today. And as the funeral feast started, Thorradr and his men walked into the hall, all dripping wet. They sat down around the fire and joined in the funeral feast until the fire burned down to embers, and then they left. And so this tells us that they were well received by the goddess Ran. So again, it says tells us that dead people typically kept the body they had when they died. Drowned people were wet. Wounded people had their battle wounds. So again, all of this tells us something about what these old Eddas, this old poetry, suggests about the walking dead. And there seem to be multiple kinds of walking dead in these old tales. Draugr, which is ghost. So basically someone who has died but now roams free. Someone who can't bear the thought of leaving this world. Maybe someone who lusts after his treasure and doesn't want to leave his treasure. Or someone is filled with evil or filled with the thirst for revenge, who has to stay on this earth even after his death to take care of that unfinished business. One aspect of this belief in the walking dead is the belief in the power of words. So for instance, if I say before I die, I'm going to come back and kill you when I die. That's a certainty that I will be a ghost. It's a certainty that after my death, I will be a Draugr. Another type of these walking dead is Huigbui, which is translates basically a mound dweller. It's the dead man in his grave mound, and he sits there and he guards his treasure. He lives there as if it was his house, as if he were alive in his grave mound. He's basically literally alive in the ground. He lives there as if it was his home. And another type, Ufaknir, which basically means zombie, someone who has been raised up from the dead by a sorcerer and sent to someone, sent out to do the sorcerer's bidding. The usual translation is zombie. It's not the Caribbean style of zombie who shuffles around mindlessly. It's a living person who acts more or less like a normal person. Now, there's other sorts of creatures that are dead and alive at the same time. And rather than talking about a lot of them, I'd just like to give one example, and that's the Fylgja, which is basically your disembodied soul. It's only seen in dreams or by people with second sight. And if you see your own Fylgja, it's a sure sign that you're about to die. So let's look at some of the undead in the saga, some of the types of these walking dead. Draugr, there's many types of Draugr, many examples of Draugr, but perhaps the most memorable example is the ghost Glaumr in Grettis saga. And he lived on the farm at Thorhaldsdali, which was located on this side of the river. There's a modern farm on the other side, but the ancient farm where the ghost was on the other side of the river here in the north of Iceland. Glaumr was a particularly evil ghost, causing all kinds of problems. Killed many people, killed a lot of livestock, drove all of the farmers out of the valley. And so Grettir decided to take on the task of ridding the farm of this evil ghost. An example of a Huigbui also comes from Grettir saga, you know, the mound dweller. Kaur the Old, Kaur Hindamli, was a mound dweller that Grettir met up with. He sat in his mound guarding the treasure, and when Grettir went in to grab the treasure, the mound dweller grabbed him and they fought. One aspect of these mound dwellers is the Huig Eldr, fires that rise up out of the grave mound. And that's how Grettir found this grave mound. He saw the fires on a headland and he realized there was a grave mound there. So he asked the local people who was in the grave mound. He learned that it was Kaur. And these types, these two types of walking dead appear again and again and again in the sagas. And so I'd like to look at them in a little bit of detail based on the information we have in the sagas. First, what is it that these creatures do? Well, they do all kinds of really terrible things. They cause a lot of harm. They're very physical creatures. They have a body. They appear as such in a body. You have to fight them in the body. They're dead, but they're also quite literally alive. They kill by crushing or beating their victims. The sagas often say that the ghost killed someone by breaking every bone in their body. They make you insane. They cause disturbance, such as riding the house, where they get up on the top of the house and kick the side of the house with their feet. They cause a huge amount of noise. They rock the house. They destroy the house when they ride the house. They drive animals insane, so the animals run off. They kill livestock and birds. They use magic for evil. For instance, Glaumr used evil. He put a curse on Grettir. They destroy settlements. They drive people out of settlements. And potentially, they create other ghosts, other Draugr. What do they look like? Basically, they look like what they looked like when they were put into the grave. Drowned men look wet, soaking wet. People who have wounds still have their wounds as they walk about. They have the color of death, so they're often reported as being black. And they're often reported as being huge and bloated, like they've filled up with something. They're much bigger than normal size. There's a few other strange states of existence that I'd like to talk about that are mentioned in the sagas. dead, yet also alive at the same time. Eyrbyggja saga tells the story of Thursted. Thursted lived in the farm at Helgafell. The modern farm is right here at the foot of the holy mountain, Helgafell, in the west of Iceland. And the saga tells us that Thorstein's shepherd saw the mountain open up, and inside was fires and feasting and merriment and commotion of all kinds, quite a wild party. And the shepherd also saw Thorstein and his men walk into the mountain and be welcomed into the feast. He returned to the house and told the housewife what he saw. And the next day, it turned out that Thorstein and his men had all drowned in a boating accident. So dead, but somehow welcomed into the feast inside this holy mountain. A few more examples. Gisla saga is set here in the valley of Hvikadalr in the west of Iceland. And Gisla saga talks about hellskor, hell shoes, which is sort of an interesting concept. I'd like to say a few words about that. Gisli's brother-in-law, Vistid, was killed, murdered in his bed in the middle of the night. No one really knew who did it. And in the funeral that followed, and the grave mound is somewhere behind me in that section of trees right there. But Vistin's, when he was being buried, Gisli put hell shoes on the man. And he said, it's the custom to tie on hell shoes so that the dead can wear them on their journey to Valhalla. So it suggested at least some people after they died had to walk to Valhalla. So they needed these hell shoes for their journey. And Gisli also added, he tied on the shoes very firmly, and it says, if these come off, I don't know how to tie on hell shoes. The story continues. Gisli believed that the killer was another brother-in-law, Thorgrimur. So Gisli entered Thorgrimur's house in the middle of the night and murdered him in his bed. When Thorgrim was buried and his grave mound was located somewhere in this general area here, people noticed that his grave was always green. Snow never settled on his grave. Now, he was a Gothi. He was a priest. And he was devoted to Freyr. And so he sacrificed to Freyr. And so people said, oh, it must be because the god loves Thorgrimur so much that he doesn't want snow between the man and the god. So it suggests some belief that these people still were alive in their graves after their death. So those are some of the stories that are mentioned in the sagas. And now I'd like to fast forward, jump ahead a bit to more modern times. So we're talking now about the Renaissance and the time that comes after that. And most of this falls into the category of folklore. So a lot of this information comes from Jonsson, our interview with him. He was just filled with good information about magic and sorcery and walking dead. Now, a lot of this is also in the folk tales compiled by Jon Arneson. And some of this is confirmed in court documents, particularly the witchcraft trials in the 17th century in Iceland. So a lot of these stories are confirmed by legal documents. So we have multiple sources that all point in some of the same directions. And there's a type of walking dead that doesn't much appear in the sagas. It's really more in the folklore era, and that's Uppvaktinger, the zombies, literally the walking dead, someone who's been raised up from the grave by a sorcerer to do the sorcerer's bidding. And Christians were often the sorcerers who raised the dead. They were the main players, and we can talk a little bit more about this. The word fjölkunnugur means skilled in magic. And the literal meaning of the word is many knowledge. It's this knowledge that allows these sorcerers to do these magical acts. It's this knowledge and learning that gives them the power and the control over the environment that they seek. They want this control so that they can make the future the way they want it to be, rather than simply accepting what comes to them. So it is nowhere better illustrated than in the heathen stories of Odin, who gave up an eye for this kind of magical knowledge. He sought this knowledge so that he could become the master of magic. But it was in the later period, Christians, educated by the church primarily, who were these magicians and sorcerers. And a couple of examples from Holar, a settlement in a town in the north of Iceland. For centuries, it was the seat of the bishop of the church in Iceland. It was also the center of learning in North Iceland, a massive school, probably it would be better called a university, existed there for centuries in Iceland. And recent archaeological digs on the site suggest that not only was it a large town by medieval Icelandic standards, it was a large town by medieval European standards. This was quite a massive place. The first printing press in Iceland was here in this town. And so it's not surprising that people in this, you know, associated with the school, associated with this church, associated with this settlement, would seek out magic. And one of them was Gottskalk Grimi. He was the bishop at Holar. And he had a book of magic called Röðskinna, Red Skin. And the magic in this book was said to be so powerful that it could defeat Satan himself. So this was a book that many desired. And centuries after the death of Gottskalk, another educated man at Holar by the name of Galdr Loftr tried to get his hands on the book. The book was buried with the bishop, so it had been in the grave for centuries. And this man used magic to raise not only Gottskalk, but several of the other bishops in Holar to get his hands on the book. And this illustration shows that moment. He almost has his hands on it when a schoolboy sees what's going on and he rings the church bell and everyone goes back down into their graves. And so Galdr Loftr never got his hands on the book. And this is a magical story that survives today in a play, multiple plays, is that right? Yeah, multiple plays that where this episode is a central part of the story. Now, there's other ways of raising the dead. One is magical staves. You know, these magical staves are a combination of runes that try to create a fusion of ideas in a single symbol. So this is one that's very well known. Many people have seen this. It's actually the symbol of a district in West Iceland, I beg your pardon. But this stave here is one used for raising the dead. And the way to use it is you inscribe this on the scalp of a horse using a mixture of seal blood, fox blood, and human blood. And you recite a verse over the stave when you wish to use it. There are stones that can be used for giving life to something that is dead or healing something that is severely wounded. And these healing stones, lífsteinn is the Icelandic name for them, appear in the sagas. There are swords that have healing stones associated with them. So if you cause a wound with the sword, you can use the stone that goes along with the sword to heal that wound, if you so choose. But in the later times, in the folklore times, they talk about ways of getting your hands on these life stones so that you can raise people from the dead and heal people. And one of the ways of getting this is through ravens, because it was believed that ravens give life to their young with these healing stones, these life stones. So here's how to get one. First, you find a raven's nest that has hatchlings in it. You kill every hatchling but one and throw them away. The last hatchling, you squeeze until it dies. And then you put it in the nest with its head up, and you stick a piece of wood, a small piece of wood, into its beak to hold it open. And then the raven, the parents, will put a stone in the hatchling's mouth. So you come back to the nest in 2 or 3 days, and the hatchling will be alive again, and there'll be a stone inside about the size of a pea, which you can take out, and that becomes your life stone. So that is how to get your own life stone. Another practice is Kara Naufrode. It's basically licking the foam from a dead man's mouth. And so the way it translates, Kara, that's the verb used for describing how a cow licks its newborn calf to bring life into it. And Naufrode is the foam that appears and around a dead man's mouth. So licking that foam is often an essential part of raising people from the dead. So here is a description of how to raise a dead man. You have to do it at night between a Friday and a Saturday. It has to be on the 18th to 19th of a month or the 28th or 29th of a month. And it doesn't matter which month or which week or anything else, as long as you do it on those days. The night before, the sorcerer should write down the Lord's Prayer in reverse. And then you carve runes on a piece of wood while reciting the Lord's Prayer in reverse from that paper that you've written down. There's also several magical formulas. The grave will start to become unrestful. Something will start to happen there. And the sorcerer will see all sorts of visions and illusions in front of him. The ghost feels he needs to move. And the ghost says, "Let me lie or be still." The sorcerer cannot be startled. He cannot pray to the Lord, but must continue. He must continue saying the magic spells. And he must turn over this wooden board until the ghost is halfway up. And as that happens, he has to make sure that none of the dirt from the grave falls outside of the grave because it can't be put back in again. He asks the ghost two questions. First, who were you in life and how old are you? No, I'm sorry. Who were you in life and how great of a man are you? And other sources say you just ask one question, how old are you? What's important here is you don't want a ghost, a zombie, that's too powerful, as we'll see in a minute. If the ghost says he's average or more than average, you've got to stop there and put him back. You don't want so great or strong of a man that you can't control him. So usually you try to choose people who are children, basically, who have died between the age of 12 and 14. So you have that chance of controlling them. And if they're over 30, no hope.
Never had a 14-year-old.
Yeah. When the ghost is half in the grave, you can put the ghost back without any trouble if you decide that's not the right ghost for you. When the ghost comes out of the grave, there's puffs of air out of every pore of the corpse. And this is the moment that you've got to lick the foam from the mouth. And once that happens, oh, one more thing. You must put blood from under the right pinky toe of the sorcerer into the mouth of the ghost. And at that point, the ghost will now attack the sorcerer. And now, so now you grapple, now you struggle, now you wrestle. If the sorcerer wins this match, he's got a fine and dandy zombie to do his bidding. But if not, both of them will enter the grave again. And so that is how you raise a ghost, how you create a zombie, according to the folklore. Now, when we were preparing this DVD, I talked to one of my friends in Iceland, a very dear friend who has vast knowledge on a wide range of topics. And he casually mentioned that his great-grandfather was a sorcerer who had raised two zombies to work the farm where he lived. I said, "Oh, okay, that's pretty interesting." And I said, "I'd really like to see that farm. It's abandoned now, but you know, I'd like to see the site." And he warned me in the strictest possible terms, if you go to see the farm, whatever you do, do not disturb the flat rock in the home field because that's where the zombies are buried. You don't want to do anything that might cause them to leave their grave. I said, "Okay, that's pretty interesting." And I talked to some of my other friends in Iceland subsequently. They said, "Oh, yeah, that great-grandfather, he's well known as a sorcerer." I mean, this is widely accepted that this man had two zombies. But what was important was the man had to kill the zombies, had to put them back down before he died. Because if the zombies were still alive when he died, his soul would be in peril. He was a Christian. He didn't want to imperil his soul, so he had to make sure that the zombies were put back down before he died. And he did that. He did that successfully. So then the question is, how do you put down a zombie? How do you put down a ghost? Well, the sagas give us a bunch of examples. And there's first of all, you must fight this entity, this zombie, this ghost. You must fight it. It's a physical thing. It's a real thing with a body, and you've got to fight it and win the fight. You've got to, once you've taken the ghost down, first cut off the head. Take the head and put it by the buttocks. And then, importantly, walk between the head and the body. This has multiple purposes. First of all, it's shameful to the ghost, obviously putting the head by the buttocks, but more importantly, it confuses the ghost. He can't put himself back together again because someone has walked between his head and his body. So he can't be put back together. And this is what Grettir did when he fought the ghost Glaumr. Now, typically, the body of the ghost was buried in a remote place, often on the boundary between the two farms, or in some cases, even more extreme measures had to be taken. There was a ghost that's told of in Eyrbyggjasaga, Thorolfr. He was buried. He haunted the valley, constantly leaving his grave mound and causing all kinds of trouble, killing livestock, driving farmers out of their farms. And so his family was called upon, you must do something about this ghost. You can't leave him here. So his family took the body out of the grave mound and buried it in a new place. Which is this headland right here on the fjord, far from any of the farms, very remote. And so they buried him here on this headland and then built a wall across the headland so he couldn't return to the civilized lands. He had no place to go. And so he was content to stay in his mound for a long time. But eventually even that wasn't good enough and he started moving around the land, causing trouble again. So the next thing you do to a ghost, if this isn't good enough, is you take the ghost out of the grave mound again and you burn it. And so that's what they did to Thorolfr. They rolled him down to the shore of the fjord and burned him there. Now, in later times, there were even more extreme measures to make sure that the ghost didn't leave the grave mound, such as nailing, putting nails in his feet so he couldn't walk, and a number of other measures. It gives us a sense for how physical these ghosts really were. Now, in the folklore age, there were other ways of protecting yourself against ghosts. You could use herbs, and this one is a particularly good one, fjandafila. Its name literally means demon repellent. And so this was something you'd want to have in your house that maybe you wore on your hat. It was a good way to get rid of ghosts or push them away. You could use poems to help you protect you against ghosts. And this is the first two verses of many verses in this poem. And basically the poem is filled with dire imprecations about what you're going to do to the ghost, you know, bind him and do all kinds of terrible things to push the ghost away. And there was a poet and a sorcerer in the 17th century who used the plant and this poem to put down two ghosts. And so it suggests that this poem actually worked. Magic staves are also used to put down ghosts or to protect yourself against ghosts. And this was thought to be a good one to protect yourself against zombies. And the way you use this is you carve the stave into the skin of a bitch. And into the carving, you apply the blood of a black male cat who has had his throat cut under a full moon. And that will protect you against zombies. Another form of protection, trickery, common throughout all the northern folklore. Many kinds of trickery, but one of the stories in the folk tales talks of a ghost who haunted a house. And the housewife had a discussion with the ghost, faced the ghost. And the ghost boasted that he could become huge and giant. So she said, show me how big you can be. So he showed her. Oh, that was just gigantic, stupendous, tremendous. And then the housewife said, show me how small you can get. And so the ghost, and then she captured the ghost and disposed of him that way. So trickery, use trickery, many examples of that. In the sagas and the Eddas talk about trolls. Trolls, when they are hit by sunlight, turn to stone. So what you do is talk to a troll until the sun finally came up in the morning. When the sun hits him, he turned to stone, and that's what happened to this troll in West Iceland. Now there's one other point that I'd really like to make before starting to sum up. And that's this concept that these creatures, these ghosts, zombies, and so on, were very physical. They had a physical body. They were capable of doing many of the same kinds of things that live people could do, and more. And one of the things that they are capable of doing is procreating. Many examples in these folk tales of these walking dead interacting with living people. And one of the stories that's told in multiple forms in several different folk tales of a man who wanted a priest's daughter as his wife, and he was forbidden to do that. And again, he used that power of speech. He said, "I will have sex with her when I die. I can't have it when I'm living, but I will have it when I die." And he died of anguish, died basically of a broken heart because he couldn't have the woman he loved. He was buried in the churchyard. And sometime later, a boy saw that his grave was open. And so the boy put something in the grave so that the ghost couldn't re-enter the grave and waited. The ghost returned, and the boy demanded that the ghost answer his questions. And the ghost says that he had just raped the priest's daughter while she slept, and that she would have a child. And that child will become a priest. And you, the boy, will marry this woman and raise that son. And that son will be the brightest in all the world as a priest. And when he preaches his first sermon, the church will sink into the ground unless someone is brave enough to drive, to stab him through his heart. So everything goes as the ghost says. The boy marries the woman. Their son grows to become a priest. And as that priest gives his first sermon, the man, who was the boy, stabs the ghost through the heart. And after he's dead, all that they find in his body is a shoulder blade, a liver, and 3 drops of blood. That was all from his mother. All the rest was from the ghost and is gone.
Good story.
And another story, a little bit of a twist to it. A folktale tells of an Icelander who raises from the dead a Dutch sailor who had died in Iceland to be a zombie, to do his bidding. So he goes through all this, he raises up the zombie, and he commands the zombie, and the zombie stands there dumb until it's realized that the Dutch sailor doesn't speak Icelandic. So where are these ghosts today? There was a fascinating article in Morgunblaðið, which is one of the major Icelandic newspaper, in the year 2000, which talks about where are the ghosts today. The title of the article, "Ghosts Are Not So Harmful Like They Used to Be." And what the reporter talks about is that ghosts have stopped being physical. They've stopped riding houses, they've stopped killing animals, and they've stopped impregnating women. Basically, they're turning to vapor and disappearing. The ghosts have faded and become more and more air-like in modern times. The author writes that it's still difficult to defeat a ghost, and it's good to carry things like the herb, fjandafila, on the hat or on your chest to protect against ghosts. But he also confirms that the only defense against the ghosts is against their physical body, not their spirit. And he says that the belief in the ghosts haven't changed that much, but the ghosts have changed. They have become vapor ghosts. And so that's sort of the state of ghosts today. So there are beings in the northern culture who have died but continue to live. And we read about them in the Eddas, in the Sagas, in the early modern period, in the folklore. And this belief is that these walking dead are real. These beliefs help explain to us what we read in the sagas. The beliefs help us understand the Viking mindset that's so important to our research here at Hurstwic. And it sheds some light on aspects of heathen religious beliefs that might not have been considered before. They show us that some aspects of these heathen beliefs continue into modern times. You know, aspects that can't be tamed in modern times. This knowledge, this part of magic, you know, magic is many knowledge. And when Christianity was adopted, many aspects of these heathen beliefs remained. And some of these aspects are this belief in magic, this belief in the walking dead. So understanding these beliefs, understanding this aspects of the heathen religions and beliefs, helps us understand more about these ancient people. And so that's why it was so important to us to study it and have a better understanding of it.